If a Jew dares to dream a dream, believe him that this may come true. For 2,000 years, our people, the classic refugees of the world, those were always the candidates to be massacred, to be discriminated against, to be second and third and tenth class citizens in all parts of the world. Despite of that, our people for 2,000 years in exile had the courage to dream a big dream. One day, we will come back to the land from which we were driven twice before. We will there establish again our sovereignty. We will work, we will with our own hands create everything in that country. We will live at peace with our neighbors and in peace with the entire world. My friend, at least part of that dream has come true.
Those were the words of Golda Meir, words which clearly sum up the purpose of her life and work. I well remember the day she spoke them. It was October 6, 1969. She had just been introduced to the 8th Constitutional Convention of the FFL-CIO, and she had stood silently at the podium, shielding her eyes from the television lights, looking out over the convention hall. Then, pointing her finger, she said, "I've been looking around for the carpenter's sign. That is the union my father belonged to," and the delegates loved her.
As the AFL-CIO's Lane Kirkland said, "We all loved her, and how she was loved and respected. For Golda was one of the most remarkable public figures of the 20th century. Golda the teacher, Zionist, kibbutz pioneer, labor activist, ambassador to the USSR, minister of labor and of foreign affairs, and finally, prime minister of Israel. A woman who devoted her incredible energy and her iron will to a single dream. The reestablishment of a nation for the Jewish people, a nation that helped solve the 2,000 years of diaspora and all of its oppression and horror. Her dream was the creation of the Third Commonwealth of Israel, and she saw the dream fulfilled. Her life story and the rebuilding of the State of Israel are one. What drove Golda to devote her life to overcoming one obstacle after another in the immense struggle to forge a new nation? Clara Stern, Golda's younger sister, explains.
Golda was born in Russia in 1898, May 3rd. While we were living in Kiev, she saw my father boarding the windows because he was fearful of a pogrom. Even at that age, she knew that our family was in danger simply because they were Jewish. When she was about 7 years old, there was a Kishinev pogrom in which many Jews had been killed and wounded. The family all decided to fast. Golda said she too was going to fast. And my mother said to her, "It isn't necessary for you to fast, only adults fast." And Golda said, "You fast for the adults and I will fast for the little children." Golda once said that if there was any logical explanation for the direction that her life took, maybe the explanation was her desire and determination to save young Jewish children from the experiences she had in Russia.
It was the activities of her older sister, Shana, that first turned Golda towards a life of activism. In Russia, Golda often listened to the political meetings that Shana held in their home. She heard words such as socialism and Zionism, and learned that if a goal was worthwhile, it was worth struggling for. In 1903, her father, Moshe Yitzhak Mabovich, left Russia for the United States. 3 years later, he brought the rest of the family over to settle in Milwaukee.
Golda was an outstanding student. Her one desire was to become a teacher. My parents were opposed to it. There was a law in Wisconsin that no married teachers would be able to teach in the public schools. My father also said, half jokingly, but also seriously, that anyway, men didn't like girls who were too smart. Because she was so anxious to be a teacher, she ran away from home and joined my sister Shana, who at that time was living in Denver. While she was in Denver, she met and fell in love with her future husband, Morris. After living in Denver for a few years, she returned to Milwaukee because my mother was very ill and my father had written to her asking her to come back. But the discussions that she heard at my sister Shana's home had influenced her whole way of thinking.
In 1917, Golda and Morris were married. In the following years, Golda traveled frequently, making speeches for the Labor Zionist Party. 4 years later, carrying out Golda's Zionist beliefs, they emigrated to Palestine. There they spent 2 years on a kibbutz in Merhavia. Conditions on the kibbutz were primitive. Food was scarce, sanitation was poor, and the work was strenuous. In short, it was a physically demanding, uncomfortable existence. For Golda, there was never a question of women's liberation in her personal life. She accomplished as much as any man in the struggle to create a Jewish homeland. But certainly, the question of what role women should play was discussed frequently among the early Jewish settlers in Palestine. And Golda recalled her memories of it to Hadassah, the Women's Zionist Organization of America.
If we speak about the second Aliyah, for instance, that was what the women were struggling for. An equal role, not equal privileges or equal rights, but they fought for carrying the burden equally. That is, they didn't, uprising was against the traditional role of the Jewish woman in the home. And they wanted to be part and parcel of all the dangers, for instance, in Haganah in those years, and work in the field, and do everything, so that it was not a struggle for certain rights, but it was the struggle to participate fully in the duties and difficulties and dangers and so on.
In the late 1920s, Golda, the committed socialist, became active in Histadrut, the Jewish Federation of Labor. She was appointed secretary of the Women's Labor Council in 1928. Golda spent much of the early 1930s in the United States working for the pioneer women. One of its activities was raising funds for the agricultural training farms for women in Palestine. 50 years later, at the Golden Anniversary Convention of the Pioneer Women, Golda stated again to her American friends what she believed then and now.
But I'm convinced that Israel and the Jewish people and the future of the Jewish people are interdependent. One cannot possibly exist without the other. And the entire purpose for a state and the justification for our young men giving what they are giving, their lives for the state, is not only for those Jews who are in Israel. It's to secure the future of the Jewish people wherever they may be.
In 1938, the International Conference on Refugees was convened in France to consider aid to the Jews of Europe living under the Third Reich. Golda attended, but to her horror and frustration, the conference took no significant action. Then in May of 1939, the British closed the door to further Jewish emigration to Palestine. Time had run out for the Jews of Europe. Golda told the Anti-Defamation League of the B'nai B'rith what an independent Israel might have meant to the Jews who perished in the Holocaust.
I'm convinced, for instance, that if during the Holocaust, if during the Second World War, during the Nazi regime, if there had been a Jewish state at that time, I don't say that we could have saved all of the 6 million Jews. But there's no doubt whatsoever in my mind that many of them would have been saved, because during the darkest hours of that period, we were dependent upon the number of certificates that we got from another power as to how many Jews we can bring into the country. If the doors of Israel had been open as it is today, many of those that are not here anymore would have been alive. Many of those children that were sent to the gas chambers would have been alive. We would have brought them here.
Father, can you answer me? Why is there such bigotry? Why were tribes of Israel lost? Why was there a Holocaust? If we live by holy law, why is man still waging war? Is it all a travesty? Father, can you answer me?
When the war ended and the horrifying magnitude of the Holocaust became known, the British still refused to allow the Jewish survivors to enter Palestine. Immigrants caught by the British were sent to displaced person camps on Cyprus. So Palestine became a battleground, with the Jews having to fight both the British and Arabs. The strife continued until the fall of 1947. In November, the British, realizing that they could no longer control the Zionist movement, turned the situation in Palestine over to the United Nations. The UN commission that was sent to Palestine recommended that the territory be partitioned into a Jewish state and an Arab state. The Arabs refused to accept the plan. It was now apparent to David Ben-Gurion and other leaders that the emerging Jewish state would have to fight Arab armies, which greatly outnumbered the forces of the Haganah. Thus, he sent Golda to the United States to raise money for the purchase of arms and ammunition. The last speech Golda gave in the United States was in 1977 in Dallas to the General Assembly of the Council of Jewish Federations and Welfare Funds. At that time, she recalled the words that she told the same General Assembly of Jewish Federations almost 30 years ago in Chicago on the eve of independence in 1948.
And I remember telling you what happened with a group of university students that were being sent through the hills to come to the aid of the men and women in the settlements in Kfar Etzion. They were beleaguered. We could get nothing to them, no help. And these students started out by foot, a roundabout way through the hills. An Arab shepherd saw them. They didn't pay any attention. They walked right on. But he got his message to the Arabs in Kfar Etzion. And these men were attacked. Not one remained alive. When we found the bodies, some of them had stones in their hands. Their ammunition had given out. They tried to fight with stones. And I told you people that were there in Chicago that we in Palestine then, have no alternative. We have decided not to run, not to give up. We know we will be attacked. Actually, we are already being attacked in Jerusalem and on the roads and elsewhere. And we will fight with what we have, if necessary, with stones.
The conclusion of Golda's dramatic appeal to that Chicago Federation meeting is taken from Golda's autobiography, My Life. These powerful and persuasive words are read by Marion Seldes.
I want to close by paraphrasing one of the greatest speeches that was made during the Second World War, the words of Churchill. I'm not exaggerating when I say that in Palestine they will fight in the Negev and will fight in Galilee and will fight on the outskirts of Jerusalem until the very end. You cannot decide whether we should fight or not. We will. The Jewish community in Palestine will raise no white flag for the Mufti. That decision is taken. Nobody can change it. You can only decide one thing: whether we shall be victorious in this fight or whether the Mufti shall be victorious. That decision American Jews can make. It has to be made quickly, within hours, within days. And I beg of you, don't be too late. Don't be bitterly sorry 3 months from now for what you failed to do today. The time is now.
In 6 weeks of speeches, Golda obtained pledges of $50 million from the American Jewish community, prompting Ben-Gurion to say, there was a Jewish woman who got the money that made Israel possible. On May 14, 1948, Israel declared its independence. Almost immediately, the United States became the first nation to recognize the Jewish state. But the Arab armies still attacked. By mid-June, however, the Israelis had defeated them on all fronts. The dream of a Jewish state had been fulfilled. Another dream was fulfilled in May 1948. Golda later poignantly described it in a speech to the UN in 1956.
The same day, in May 1948, that Egyptian bombs began to fall on Tel Aviv, the first Jewish refugee ship from the camps in Germany reached the shores of Israel. 6 million of the 7.25 million Jews of Europe outside of the Soviet Union had been slaughtered by the Nazis. And now the survivors were coming back, not as the banned illegals of the mandatory regime, but to the greeting prophesied by Jeremiah, thy children shall come back to their border.
The new government appointed Golda minister to the Soviet Union, a post she only reluctantly accepted, for she preferred to serve her country at home. A most prominent question in the minds of that first Israeli delegation was, what remained of the Jewish community in the Soviet Union? Elie Wiesel relates what happened.
That event mattered in her life. She often referred to it. She often evoked it with pride, sadness, and glory. She arrived in Russia in 1948 as Israel's first ambassador. She didn't know, she couldn't have known, that she would find Jews there, good Jews, loyal Jews. And then, on Rosh Hashanah, she came to the central synagogue in Archipova Street. And within an hour, there were hundreds and hundreds of Jews from all over the city. They had gathered outside the synagogue, waiting for her, in the thousands, waiting an hour, two, three. And she, Golda, representing Jewish sovereignty for the first time in Russia, she was almost a prisoner of those prisoners. They tore her clothes to pieces. They spoke to her, they kissed her, they embraced her, they cried, so did she. And they put pieces of paper in her pockets, messages, notes. We all know them. Am Yisrael Chai. Thank you for surviving. Thank you for not forgetting us. And she, in return, said to them, Am Yisrael Chai. Thank you for surviving. Thank you for not forgetting us. Yes, that was an event that mattered in her life.
Israel had won its war of independence, but it was soon faced with another kind of crisis, a financial crisis. It was inevitable. 200,000 immigrants, mostly survivors of the Holocaust, were flooding Israel's shores each year. Somehow the infant nation would have to feed, clothe, shelter, and employ the new arrivals. There were other financial problems as well. The two-year-old nation needed vast sums of money to build factories and to develop its agriculture. So it was that in October of 1950, leaders of major Jewish organizations met in Washington, D.C. to consider floating an Israel bond issue in the United States. Golda, who had become Israel's Minister of Labor and Public Works, spoke before the conference calling for American support of the bond issue. Golda offered a very special type of security for this bond issue. Marion Seldes quotes her.
There is only one kind of security that I think I can offer you on behalf of the government of Israel. I can offer you the gilt-edged security of the people of Israel, the hundreds of thousands of Jews who will still come to Israel, and the tens of thousands of Jews in Israel who live in tents. But also I can offer you our children, the children of the old-timers and the little Yemenite children and the Iraqi children and the Romanian children who are growing up in Israel. Proud, safe, self-respecting Jews. They will pay back this debt, which they are honor-bound to pay back, with interest.
Golda had made her point. Israel bonds became an overwhelming success, providing Israel with over $4 billion since 1950. And of course, Golda continued over the years to make speeches in the United States and Canada in support of the bonds as a means of keeping Israel strong and secure.